You're listening to the audio production of Unspoken, Toxic Masculinity, and How I Faced a Man Within the Man by Guvna B. Published by Harper Inspire and read by the author, with a special appearance by Vivian Bourquet. Keep listening at the end of this audiobook for a bonus interview with Guvna B, hosted by Nihal Arthanayake. Please note that you can download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
Dedication to my dad Charles and my son Ezra. With each generation, there is as much to learn as there is to teach. Love you both. Introduction. Toxic masculinity, a cultural concept of manliness that glorifies stoicism, strength, virility, and dominance, and that is socially maladaptive or harmful to mental health. Dictionary.com. In 2017, my world turned upside down when my dad died suddenly and unexpectedly. One moment he was on the L-shaped sofa watching Match of the Day, full of smiles, and the next day, gone, vanished from my world. I was 27 years old and had never taken a moment to consider my life without my dad by my side. His death plunged me into the depths of despair, where I lost all sense of who I was. I felt lost and alone, and lacked the necessary tools for coping with a bewildering sense of grief. All my life, I have struggled to communicate, but with the death of my dad, my inability to impart how I was feeling had a massive impact on my mental well-being. As a black man of Ghanaian origin raised on a London council estate, many of my influences conditioned me to believe that boys don't cry, that men are tough, that we can handle ourselves through thick and thin, and that we are immune to every emotion. The disadvantages we faced left no room for emotions to delay our progress. I was also unable to share how I felt as I was scared of being judged, of being seen as weak and vulnerable and out of control. It was my struggle to communicate in everyday conversation that initially led me to songwriting, and I am eternally grateful for having had the opportunity to turn both this need and passion into a living. Known professionally as Guvna B, I am a rapper, the recipient of 2 MOBO Awards and 3 Urban Music Awards. My music has amassed over 20 million streams. At the time of writing, my latest album, Everywhere and Nowhere, is the highest selling clean rap album of 2020, and I have over 100,000 followers across social media. Even though writing music is my exhale, the release of all the pent-up thoughts in my head, I've always felt that the influence I've gained through music can be used for even greater things. I have always sought to offer positivity through my lyrics, to break down the stereotype of rap music as centering only on drugs, sex, and violence, and to share hope and inspiration. It was only after my dad died, however, that I learned how to truly express my pain and to face the man I was within. I had to. My survival depended on it. What I was not expecting was the overwhelming response I received for my honesty, at opening up and revealing my defenselessness. The messages I received were full of heartfelt thanks, largely from young men, for telling it like it is, for showing them that it's okay to bare their souls. That vulnerability, fear, and anxiety are human traits that affect us all, regardless of our gender. My dad's death marked a turning point in my life. By removing the blinkers from my world and the world around me, I was granted a new sense of purpose. The purpose of helping those around me to cut through the conditioning that comes as part and parcel of being male, and to help young men obtain the courage to open up and expose the fragility lying just beneath the surface. I am not an expert on mental health, or grief, or youth violence. I don't have any formal qualifications to write about these subjects, but what I do have is several years' worth of word of mouth and hands-on experience, in addition to caring deeply about these topics. This book is aimed at all young people, but as a black man, I know about the trials and tribulations that black men face in trying to carve a path in an already overcrowded white person's world. And I write from a black man's perspective. I ask questions relevant to young black men, start the necessary conversations that concern black men, and listen to what young black men have to say. As a man of faith, I have always felt the need to help other people. I see it as my God-given purpose to do good in this world. Although my music is my passion, I place great value on the work I do mentoring young people. I joined the Eastside Young Leaders Academy and mentored secondary school kids when studying for my degree, and I have continued mentoring ever since. Through my charity, AlloMate, I provide opportunities for aspiring young musicians to launch their careers in the music industry. I am deeply involved in my work as an ambassador with the overseas development charity, Tear Fund. I present a podcast called The Lost Tapes on grief and its impact on mental health. Have given motivational speeches at venues such as Wembley Arena and the O2, and work as a broadcaster and documentary presenter for the likes of the BBC on matters relating to music and young people. This book is an extension of the many conversations I have outside and alongside my music career. Knowing that I can make a difference in young people's lives is my inspiration for writing Unspoken. I see this book as an older brother. An older brother cares, an older brother protects. An older brother is relatable, and an older brother is further along the path. The older brother knows that there is likely going to be a moment in your life when you come face to face with who you really are. I had that moment, and it took me a long time to set myself straight. I don't want you to have the same experience. I'm not even fully straight yet. I'm kind of like a bendy ruler. In this book, I dig deep to discover the man within. And I learned that only by being honest and attuned to my emotional self have I got a chance of cutting my teeth in this world. A world where survival does not rest on being the toughest, but on knowing who you are and having the confidence and the courage to show it. Note: all pictures referenced in this book can be found in the accompanying PDF. Chapter 1: First Generation Brit. I was born Isaac Charles Borte Borkwe on a council estate in East London. My parents moved from Ghana to England in their early 20s with hopes of starting afresh and creating something meaningful for themselves and their children. Hard work was in their DNA, and every fibre of their being was dedicated to building something substantial and sustainable. I'm a first generation Brit, and so were many other kids in the area. It was such a diverse place to live. We had working class English people who had lived on the estate for generations, as well as Ghanaians, Nigerians, Algerians, Jamaicans, Dominicans, Portuguese, Polish, and so many more whose parents had moved to call this place home. Immigration is often a divisive word, but on an estate like mine, it united people, gave them common ground to stand on and build from. There were many conversations that showed me we were all different, but in a lot of ways, all the same. At the time, I thought my mental and emotional states when growing up were excellent, but the person I am today agonizes for the teenage Isaac. The truth of the matter is, I was emotionally debilitated, with melancholy filling up my days all too often. Pinning that down to one reason is tough, but first-generation Brits from a working-class background know that growing up in a deprived area comes with many problems, which don't always present themselves as negative. As I attempt to peel back the layers, the way I've come to understand my emotional immaturity is the fact that when I was growing up, there wasn't time to express emotions. My parents were on a mission to further the legacy of our family. They had given up familiarity, the home they knew, being close to their family, being comfortable with the ordinary and everything else for this opportunity. There wasn't any way that emotion was getting in the way of that. Their hunger for greatness was infectious and something they passed on to my younger brother and me. When I put myself in their shoes, I get it. They were in a fight for survival. At one point, we lived in a single room with little money for basic household needs. They didn't have time to sit down on a regular basis and discuss in a healthy way how they felt about the situation. They were too busy trying to make the rent that month. I had an abundance of aspiration in my household, but a lack of it on the estate from my peers. We lived from day to day. We didn't really wake up and think, I have a purpose, and I'm going to work towards that today. I guess most of us never saw past the estate. It's weird when I think about it because The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air was one of my favourite shows. Every day at 5 p.m, I'd come home from school and it would be on the television. I'd see Uncle Phil and Auntie Vivian's big mansion and all the resources they had for their family, but not once did I think that was something I could attain. Not once did I think America was even somewhere I could go. We rarely saw past the estate, but then again, it's hard to visualise something you haven't personally experienced. One of the only youth clubs in the area got shut down, so we'd just hang around on the streets or on the communal green, and then we'd go home and see our parents struggling to make ends meet. We started to think that this was all life had to offer, and didn't share our feelings often with those close to us, because things weren't likely to get better, so what's the point? Another layer was toxic masculinity, which was rife. I remember having a fight when I was about 12 years old with a guy who was a couple of years older than me, over a silly PlayStation game, and a heated argument got out of hand. I was punched in the face and it hurt, obviously, and pain plus extreme anger can result in tears. I remember the guy asking, "Why are you crying?" I'm guessing because it hurt. The message that something like that sent out was that even if you're in pain, and even if you felt like it, you didn't dare cry because we don't do that around here. This became problematic when friends from the estate lost their lives to youth violence, and we didn't grieve properly because we didn't do emotion. We suppressed the sadness, the hurt, the loss, and life seemingly went on. We're all conditioned in some way, shape, or form, and that's something to bear in mind. We're conditioned to behave in a certain way or accept certain circumstances. It's the reason me and my friends viewed success as being the local kingpin of the drug trade rather than the guy we saw suited and booted walking to the train station at 8 a.m. to start his job at JP Morgan. The kingpin wore Nike Air Max 90s. The three-piece suit and Oxford shoes of Mr. JP Morgan cost more than the Nike trainers, but we didn't care. Success looked like Air Max 90s to us. Where was that? Conditioning. If you were to ask me how I describe myself, it would be laid back, logical, and a man of faith. I definitely get the laid back nature from my dad. He had a spot on the L-shaped sofa we have in the front room. Whenever I walked into the house, I could bet my last pound he'd be chilling in that spot watching Formula One or an African soap of some sort. In earlier years, he'd have the teletext screen on and just read that. How weird. I'm probably sharing my age, but you can Google image teletext if you're not familiar with it. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is he was very, very chilled. Cool as a cucumber in Antarctica. I don't remember ever seeing him act erratically or show his anger externally. Living life that way seemed to bring him peace, and that kind of tranquility is something I aspire to. I remember making a vow to myself to hold things lightly and not allow myself to get worked up, so that I could maintain my peace like my dad seemed to do so well. I figured that I couldn't always control what people did to me, but I could control how I responded to it. The need to constantly improve on myself is my logical nature. My life is busy, and I only have limited brain capacity, so if I want to keep my sanity, I have to compartmentalize. This way, I ensure I only worry about what I need to worry about when it becomes a worry. I am often accused of being so logical that I come across as emotionally distant and unable to empathize with the people closest to me. People say, "You need to let off steam, Isaac." But in truth, it's my logical nature and ability to see the big picture that keeps me on track. I am often asked how I can be logical at the same time as carrying a strong faith. Surely the two are incompatible. The way I see it is that my faith requires no analysis. It's not something I choose to opt in or out of. It's a part of me, as dear to me as my heart and lungs. I get that it's not logical to believe, but where God is concerned, there isn't always a time or place for logic. My faith is my lifeblood, and my belief non-negotiable. My parents are Ghanaian, and Christians too, so that usually means we children go to church as soon as we depart the womb, whether we like it or not. Though I was heavily persuaded to go, I became mature enough over the years to develop my own thoughts and ideas on what I believed. I doubted the church on various occasions, but for some reason, I never doubted God. It wasn't a theological epiphany or spiritual awakening that made me feel this way, just a feeling I always had. I'd look at withering leaves or the detail on both of my palms and think to myself, I think someone created this. I think there's a mastermind behind the undeniable beauty of the things my eyes witness. Ultimately, that led me to a journey I'm still on. And even though having faith doesn't exclude me from the issues that may turn up at my door, it provides comfort knowing that I don't feel like I'm alone. I walk confidently in that, and it became a big part of my identity. So much so that I actually felt the need to live up to the chilled and faithful persona I thought I had been blessed with. This meant that in confrontations or difficult conversations...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.